book such as Richard Dawkins' contribution in particular rank on the bestseller lists. We can, of course, question whether this kind of atheism is not itself a lost cause. It can hardly be maintained that it represents the summit of contemporary thought. It reiterates in a heavy-handed and distorted manner 19th century positions which have long been considered a thing of the past. As its best-known critique, McGrath, himself a scientist, has demonstrated in detail, it is essentially an atheistic fundamentalism. McGrath speaks of an atheism delusion. In serious publications, the secularization thesis, which enjoyed a boom in the 70s and 80s, has since been largely abandoned. In the meantime, we have gained a renewed awareness that, from the perspective of universal cultural history, the secularization process of the past three centuries represents a specifically European development, not only in Asia and Africa, but also in a thoroughly modern and developed country like the United States. Western European secularization is being observed with a measure of anxiety. Moreover, in the wake of global migration patterns, the question, of course, has entered into public consciousness once more even here. The other religions, Islam above all, are attentively observed and discussed with interest, also with apprehension, and often even with fear. Within Western Europe, these developments are interwoven with self-critique in the form of a dialectic of the Enlightenment, or Adorno, which has also led to a dialectic of secularization. The internal ambivalences of modern progress has been recognized. It has become evident that it cannot be had without a cost, that in fact each gain has to be paid for with a loss. That is most clearly manifest in the ecological problems, which are the price we pay for technological progress. One-sided rationalism causes the emotional and aesthetic dimensions of humanity to atrophy and cannot answer the existential question for meaning. It is also doubtful whether the development from the slingshot to an atom bomb can be defined as human progress. Because the 19th and early 20th century promises of salvation in this world, the Western ideology of progress and the Marxist utopia of a classless society, have both proved deceptive, the so-called meta-narratives are no longer trusted. Neither the idealistic nor the materialistic overarching interpretations of reality. Instead, we find the weak thought, patimo, of postmodernism, which admits defeat in the face of mankind's great questions, including the question of God, declaring itself to be incompetent or indifferent. That truth no longer exists, only truth in plural. So the self-assuredness of militant atheism has turned into a resigned defeatism, skepticism, agnosticism, often even nihilism. That also means bidding farewell to the great ideals of the Enlightenment, the universally valid truth, and human rights. So we have arrived at post- and late modern relativism, which considers any reference to the one universal truth as presumptuous Eurocentrism and accepts the recognition of a pluralism of truth and religion alike as the new paradigm. On the other hand, the collapse of the meta-narratives has left behind an inner spiritual void. There are very few people who want to live in a purely rational, technologically functional world. So the dimensions of the emotions and aesthetics are sought once more, extending as far as a renewed interest in myth. Rapid change in practically all spheres of life gives rise once more to the question of what is permanent, what we can hold on to. So the primordial religious questions of meaning and security have once more become burning new questions for many. Religious and spiritual questioning and seeking are on the increase. There are many people, more than we think, who can be described as seekers and pilgrims. God has, as it were, become socially acceptable once more. Religion and the religions have, to a large extent, not declined as envisaged by the Enlightenment, virtually being anthropological constants. That is a theological and pastoral opportunity which we must grasp by offering compelling theology and proclamation. This new situation is, of course, ambivalent. It has given theology and the churches some breathing space, but it does not by any means signify that we are out of the woods. Habitual atheism and the prejudice that only a secular state of mind can be modern while religion is old-fashioned and out of date still prove as stubborn as they have always been. As we have seen, we are witnessing not only the return of religion, but also the return of atheism and atheistic propaganda. Therefore, it is debatable whether we are speaking of a post-secular situation or a return of religion or even a megatrend towards religion. In any case, the so-called return of religion does not simply lead back to Christian faith in God, and it does not in any account fill the empty church pews. Often it leads to an individualistic, invisible religion which discovers traces of the divine in everyday life. In many instances, one gains the impression of a cosmotheism which discovers God in nature and in the cosmos. Thus, theology can often become theology. Sometimes what is termed the return to religion is a religiosity without God, a religion like atheism. It can lead to a vague, diffused, free-floating religiosity, a syncretistic do-it-yourself-what-you-will religiosity, which narcissistically seeks the divine not above us, but in us. Finally, we find under the banner of a return to religion the phenomenon which is rightly observed by many with fear and anxiety, a fundamentalist religion which condones violence and distorts religion into its daimonic opposite. So it is right the question, is it really always and in every case God who is returning? Are we not in many instances dealing instead with the return of old and new gods? Max Weber said, and I quote, the old gods ascend from their graves, they are disenchanted and thus take the form of impersonal forces. They strive to gain power over our lives, and again they assume the eternal struggle with one another. End of quotation. In this situation, theology has a chance. But theology also faces a totally new challenge. It is non-permissible to simply become involved uncritically in the so-called religious megatrend. In this situation, theology must be understood as a rational responsibility for speaking of God. Theology is called upon to commit itself anew to its most primal intrinsic concern. Indeed, theology means nothing other than logos of theos. Augustine defines it as de divinitate ratio sive servo. Thomas Aquinas speaks even more clearly. According to him, theology deals in the first instance with God. but also his created realities insofar they are referable to God as their beginning and